Right now, as I'm making this programme, the eastern side of Australia, from Queensland down to New South Wales, is experiencing some much-needed rainfall, helping to ease the fires that have continued to burn there. This summer's wildfires have been pretty much uncontrollable, and as they've torn across great swathes of the country, they've tragically killed at least 25 people and torched about 11 million hectares of land, an area similar in size to the US state of Virginia or the European country of Bulgaria. 2,000 homes have been destroyed at an estimated cost of $700 million, and more than a billion animals are thought to have been killed, either directly by burning in the flames or by the loss of their natural habitat and food sources. Now, I'm not a climate scientist, as most of you already know, but probably like you, I'm keen to understand what's driven the extent of this year's fires and whether climate change has had any real impact on their severity. So this week I've been having a look at what the scientists are telling us, and it turns out they've got quite a lot to say. Hello and welcome to Just Have a Think. When it comes to our planet's climate, research over many years has shown that there's a multitude of influencing factors that combine in very complex and chaotic ways. And the factors determining timing, location, longevity and severity of wildfires in Australia, and for that matter in all the other geographical areas of the world, are no exception. Most folks know that bushfires are a naturally occurring event that happen each year in Australia. This research paper on fire conditions in South Africa, written by Sally Archibald and her research team in 2009, outlines the four main requirements for wildfires to get going, none of which will come as a great surprise. You need the right ambient weather conditions, the availability of fuel, the fuel to be dry and combustible, and of course you need a spark, also known as an ignition source. So has recent human-induced climate change had a bearing on any of those factors? Well, there's plenty of research showing how our planet's average atmospheric temperature is on the rise. The National Oceanic and Atmospheric Administration in the United States released this report on the 15th of January 2020, confirming that 2019 was the second hottest year on record for our planet, just behind 2016, which itself was a strong El Niño year. And in fact, the Government Bureau of Meteorology over in Australia released their own annual climate statement on the 9th of January 2020, showing that 2019 was actually the hottest Australian year on record, with average temperatures of 1.52 degrees Celsius above the 1961 to 1990 average. This chart released by the Bureau shows the areas affected, with white areas denoting average temperature, yellow areas being above average, light orange areas very much above average, and the dark orange bits experiencing the highest temperatures on record. You can clearly see how New South Wales was severely impacted. In fact, it recorded the 2019 average temperature some 1.95 degrees Celsius above the 1961 to 1990 average, beating the previous 2018 record by 0.27 Celsius. The overwhelming scientific evidence is that human emissions of carbon dioxide and other greenhouse gases are by far the main driver of increased average global atmospheric temperatures since the beginning of the Industrial Revolution, with the planet's average temperature now standing at 1.05 degrees Celsius, warmer than 1850 levels. But other research has shown how those increased CO2 levels are also exacerbating the second criterion outlined in Sally Archibald's research, the availability of fuel. This is a paper written in 2013 by Professor Andy Pittman of the Australian Government Research Council's Centre for Climate System Science. It explains how increased CO2 levels in the atmosphere act as a fertiliser for all the plants, shrubs and trees of the native Australian bush, and that causes an increase in their net primary productivity. An increase in greenery sounds like it might be a good thing for our planet, but the paper points out that in this case, the increase isn't sustainable over the long term because it's limited by the availability of nutrients. Farmers very successfully use high levels of carbon dioxide gas in their greenhouses to promote strong plant growth, but they can only achieve that because in that controlled environment they're also able to provide the right amount of water and fertiliser into the mix to feed and irrigate the crops. No such water or fertiliser is available in the Australian bush. Pittman makes the observation that when vegetation takes up CO2, it fixes it as carbon in leaves, woody matter and roots and such like. As our planet's biosphere takes up the higher levels of carbon dioxide now available in the atmosphere, so Pittman argues, it's inevitable that the biosphere will also be fixing more carbon. More carbon fixed or locked up in woody matter means more fuel for fire. And as the green vegetation also uses the additional carbon to produce more leaves, when those leaves drop, you've got even more potential fire fuel lying around on the ground. While the paper points out that more fuel on the ground doesn't in itself lead to more fires, it does mean that whenever a fire breaks out, it's got much more fuel available for it to keep on burning. But that fuel has to be dry, of course, as our original list of criteria points out. So how's that been working out down under? Well, let's go back to that 2019 climate statement from the Aussie Bureau of Meteorology. It tells us that 2019 was the driest year on record there, with rainfall 40% lower than average based on records going back to 1900. Much of Australia was hit by drought in 2019, with New South Wales and Queensland both affected particularly severely. Most of us would instinctively expect that those warmer temperatures we just looked at would probably play a big part in causing the surface of the land to become drier through evaporation and warm air circulation. Fair enough. But researchers have been discovering some other less obvious factors that are also contributing to the increasing dryness of the region. The Bureau of Meteorology tells us that as our human greenhouse gas emissions continue to increase, that increase isn't just resulting in higher levels of CO2 fixing that we looked at earlier, it's also causing the length of the growing season to extend in many parts of Australia. This chart shows the 30-year trend in growing season length between 1971 and 2011. The size of the red bubbles represents the increased length of season in that location, with some parts of the continent experiencing growing seasons that extended by 20 days or more each decade. Professor Pittman's 2013 paper explains that these longer growing seasons mean more moisture is being sucked up from the ground by trees and vegetations, and that moisture is then transferred back into the atmosphere as those plants transpire, which inevitably leads to drier earth. And as an added further irony, there's also strong evidence that the huge amounts of carbon dioxide currently being released by the bushfires are unlikely to get reabsorbed back into the ground through regrowth of forests in the way that they used to do in the balanced Australian climate systems of the past. So that's a whole load of CO2 now up in the atmosphere, causing more warming. And the globally interconnected nature of our whole planet's climate system brings a couple of other elements into play too, as the Met Bureau goes on to highlight. The first of these is something called the Indian Ocean Dipole. The dipole is an irregular movement of sea surface temperatures which, according to science speak, can have phases that are either positive, negative or neutral. In 2019, the dipole was in a positive phase, which meant that the Indian Ocean off Australia's northwest coast was cooler than normal. Positive dipole events like this tend to draw moisture away from Australia and deliver less rainfall. But surely that's a natural random event that's always been there, and there's nothing we humans can do about something like that. We just have to put it down to bad timing on this occasion, right? And no. Because once again, climate scientists are discovering increasingly strong evidence that those pesky human-induced greenhouse gas emissions are having an impact on the Indian Ocean Dipole as well. This 2018 study in the journal Nature Communications found that if our planet does reach an average global atmospheric temperature of 1.5 degrees Celsius above pre-industrial levels, which is highly likely in the next couple of decades, then the frequency of extreme positive phase dipoles in the Indian Ocean looks set to double as a result. The full explanation of how and why that happens is outside the scope of this program, but I'll link that study and all the other reports and papers that I've mentioned in this video in the comments section below. So if you want to delve into the detail, you can grab everything you need from there. I did say there were a couple of extra elements highlighted by the Met Bureau, and the second of them is a phenomenon called the Southern Annular Mode, or SAM. The SAM is a north to south progression of strong westerly winds that blow almost continuously in the mid to high latitudes of the southern hemisphere. The winds cause storms and cold fronts that bring rainfall to southern Australia. Just like the Indian Ocean Dipole, the SAM has three phases, neutral, positive and negative. As the Australian fires took hold in November and December of 2019, a sudden warming event in the stratosphere above Antarctica nudged the SAM into a negative phase, which caused those winds to track further north, blowing hot air across the country, fanning the flames and increasing the intensity of the fires. That unexpected negative phase of the SAM provided an extremely unhelpful short-term turbo boost to the bushfire crisis. This paper by Professor Neroli Abram, a climate scientist at the Australian National University, found evidence actually suggesting that climate change generally appears to be pushing SAM towards more positive phases. But when those positive phases are prominent during Australia's winter time, the ensuing winds have the effect of increasing the levels of dryness across the continent. As a kind of macabre metaphorical icing on the combustible cake, this 2019 paper by Andrew Dowdy and team finds evidence that global warming is creating more favourable conditions for a self-reinforcing phenomenon known as pyrocumulonimbus or pyro-CB storms to form, as extreme bushfires can become coupled with the atmosphere, generating their own lightning and gusty, violent and unpredictable winds. These horrendous meteorological events replace rainfall with blackened hail and embers that can be shot out over distances of 30 kilometres, making wildfire events much more dangerous. And as for the ignition source, well, earlier this month, as I'm sure many of you will no doubt have seen, Twitter lit up with claims of a big wave of arson driving the bushfires this year. Even the President of the United States of America and his best buddy Sean Hannity got into the hashtag arson emergency propaganda push, both retweeting allegations that close to 200 people in Australia had been charged with arson for deliberately lighting fires. It's almost as if they were trying to suggest that the fires were nothing to do with climate change and had been entirely cooked up by a group of pyromaniacs. While there's no doubt that some arsonists have been active in the current bushfire season, as they apparently are every year in Australia, New South Wales police say they've actually only charged 24 people with deliberately lighting bushfires this season. And officials in the state of Victoria have also refuted arson as a major cause of bushfires. A police spokesman said, "Police are aware of a number of posts circulating in relation to the current bushfire situation. However, currently there is no intelligence to indicate that the fires of East Gippsland and North East Victoria have been caused by arson or any other suspicious behaviour." Of course, all sorts of things can get a fire started during hot weather when the ground is tinder dry. Clumsy human error and accidents certainly play their part. But according to Dale Dominey Howes, a professor of hazard and disaster risk sciences at the University of Sydney, the main cause of fire ignition of Australia's bushfires is dry lightning, essentially lightning from thunderstorms that don't produce rain. Whatever the source of ignition may be, though, it does appear that our rapidly changing climate is playing a significant role in producing the perfect conditions for Australian wildfires to become progressively longer lasting and more severe in the coming years. Australia's National Environmental Science Programme was very clear in its view when it published advice back in November 2019, stating, "Human-caused climate change has resulted in more dangerous weather conditions for bushfires in recent decades for many regions of Australia. Observations show a trend towards more dangerous conditions during summer and an earlier start to the fire season, particularly in parts of southern and eastern Australia. These trends are very likely to increase into the future, with climate models showing more dangerous weather conditions for bushfires throughout Australia due to increasing greenhouse gas emissions." The President of the Australian Academy of Sciences, Professor John Shine, said Australia must take stronger action as part of the worldwide commitment to limit global warming to 1.5 degrees Celsius above the long-term average to reduce the worst impacts of climate change. And Neroli Abram, who did that research on the southern annular mode, said, "Even from my perspective, I'm surprised by just how bad 1 degree Celsius of warming is looking." She said, "It's worrying that we're talking about this as a new normal, because we're actually on an upward trajectory. Currently, the pledges in the Paris Agreement are not enough to limit us to 1.5 degrees Celsius. We're looking more like 3 degrees Celsius." That's it for this week. A big thank you to all the Patreon supporters of the channel, and especially to the Australian contingent for providing articles, research papers and first-hand reports to help with the production of this programme. I've left links to all the documents I referenced this week in the comments section below, as well as quite a lot more reading material that I received but didn't manage to squeeze in. As always, thanks very much for watching, and although I always say remember to just have a think, I feel compelled to suggest this week that our thoughts should remain squarely with the folks who've lost their homes, livelihoods and possibly even loved ones as a result of these appalling fires. See you next week.